before the draft, analyzing. I said I would have taken Darnold 1, and I'd have taken Bradley Shubb 4 if I was the Browns. I tend to like the bigger defensive player over the smaller one over mm-hmm. time. Now Denzel's been great so far. He's been great. And Baker so far has been, I think he's the most accurate. You know, I think Sam Darnold's got a lot left to grow. Baker used all 5 years of college. Mm-hmm. I think he's closer to his ceiling, but I don't think he's reached it yet. I would compare him to Kyle Kuzma of the Lakers. Mm-hmm. You go to college for 4 years, you're much more refined, you're closer to your ceiling. I think Sam's got a long way to go, and he can be sloppy and reckless. But let's talk Baker, and let's talk the Browns right now. I look at them and the Chargers, and it's a coin flip, and I think a lot of it is Browns have a good roster. They got good players.
Oh, for sure. They absolutely have good players. And I think what you said, everything you said about Baker Mayfield and even the decision that they went with Denzel Ward over Bradley Chubb, all those things are solid points. I think with Baker Mayfield, what they got was an experienced player, a right now player, meaning his experience at college, his experience playing in a number of big games at Oklahoma, the 48 games or 50 games that he played at Oklahoma. He was more ready to play in the National Football League than some of the other guys.
Yeah, those were double Allen, double Darnold, double Rosen.
And what you're seeing is he jumped into a situation where they now have given him the keys to an offense. They have some playmakers available. He's playing behind a defense that has some star players. Miles Garrett is going to be a star. People haven't talked about Christian Kirksey for a long time, but he's a solid player. Yeah. And you're seeing Denzel Ward emerge as a legitimate all-star on the outside.
Yeah, he's having a great rookie year.
Baker Mayfield is doing exactly what they asked to do. And the one thing that I can say to his credit, he brought energy. He gave that team some sauce. He gave them some confidence. He gave them some swagger, and it's playing out. The Cleveland Browns are going to be a hard out in the AFC North because talent-wise, they can match up with all the teams, and now they're beginning to win games, and they're playing with the confidence. It's going to be tough to deal with them going forward.
By the way, this is the best division in football to me.
I mean, it's very, very, very competitive. And the team that people don't talk enough about, the Cincinnati Bengals.
I don't trust them.
Oh, see, there you go. Marvin Lewis
them.
Was on the hot seat last year, but the last two games, his team played for him. And then when you go back and you look at their drafts, they've traditionally have drafted well because the Cincinnati Bengals do what a lot of teams want. They will draft talent over some of the football characteristics that will keep some teams from drafting. They took Joe Mixon. They've taken other players that may have been deemed bad character guys, but it works for them because Marvin does a good job of kind of keeping them together. And typically when they go to Cincinnati, they don't mess up or run afoul. And so this team is loaded. They're talented. The new offensive coordinator, Bill Lazor, who got a promotion last year, has helped Andy Dalton get back on track. They're a team that's also a tough team to contend with in the AFC North.
I want to talk about the Rams. I said this yesterday, is that great creates clarity.
Mm-hmm.
You watch Belichick and you're like, wow, you can be good every year. Brady's hurt. Castle in, win 11. You can. Details. Changing your game plan week to week. Personnel evaluations. And Saban's done the same. Wow. You give a guy, a good coach, all these tremendous high school players in the South, you can literally have no bumps in the road for 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Sean McVay's going to get guys fired. They look different. They're clever. I mean, we didn't talk Robert Woods and Cooper Kupp. I mean, in college or pro. You know, I look at McVay, and I think he has a chance to be one of those guys that GMs and owners look at and go, well, did you see what he did with Jared Goff? He was terrible. Then his first game, he was great. I think McVay is trouble for other coaches. Your thoughts?
He's absolutely trouble for other coaches because what he is the perfect combination that you want as a head coach. He's young, he's energetic, he's creative. He has the ability to elevate the play of the quarterback while retaining control of the team. He has the players' coach qualities while still having the disciplinarian that you want. And I think the mistake that owners are going to make, because they're going to go and hire all these young offensive guys and think they're getting McVay. What you have to understand with McVay may be 31, 32 in real years, but he's 50 in dog years. And the reason why I say that, his granddad was president of the 49ers, so he always was around. And I had sources tell me, like, look, you have to understand, he grew up around the 49ers when the 49ers were at their best. So he understands what the standard of championship football should look like. So when you ask opposing coaches about the Rams, what are the things that you hear? Man, they're so detailed. They're so disciplined. They do a great job of putting you in binds that you can't get out of. Well, who does that sound like? It sounds like the 80s and 90s 49ers. He has taken players who would be B-level players, Cooper Kupp and Robert Woods, and put them in a system that elevates them. He is everything. And his coaching staff, they do a great job of coaching it up. And the thing that I really admire about what he's done, he has taken some things offensively that are high school, collegiate-like, and he's wearing people out. Jet sweeps, double shifting motions. And he has given Jared Goff the confidence that everybody wants to see from a franchise quarterback.
One of the things we try to avoid, and you know, this show, like with Baker Mayfield, a lot of this is just fun. I like to bring Baker on and take shots at me. I do think Baker's going to be fine. I just think his ceiling's lower than everybody else.
I don't have a jersey. I didn't come Joel Klatt.
But I don't like the pile on culture we have in America. Everybody rushes to Twitter. It's just much easier to join the avalanche. Mm-hmm. Instead of defending somebody. So I said before, I said the Gruden thing to me is problematic. Now I feel like I don't want to be a bully. I do think offensively they have some really nice weapons, but Derek Carr does not look as good as Derek Carr did 2 years ago, and that's John Gruden's strength. Okay, from 30,000 feet, when I look at the Raiders now, I think John's smart. He's a terrific broadcaster. I think he knows a lot about football. But I am sensing this thing inside the building where he's got his scouts, the GM. Yeah. This is the poorest team. It's a lame duck franchise. They're moving cities. It feels like a mess, right?
Oh, it is a mess. It's a mess in a couple of different areas. You bring up the two different sets of personnel, staffs. You normally don't have a GM and their scouts. Then the head coach has his scouts, and they don't work together and they don't come together. That is not the way that I was taught in this business to do it. And the way that, like, Gruden and Reggie McKenzie, they all were around Ron Wolf. That's how I learned the game. Ron Wolf would say everyone has to work as a collaborative effort. We are all trying to make team decisions. Whether we agree or disagree, when the decision is made, it's a team decision. And so that's a little odd. But I'm going to say this about Derek Carr. And I know people are going to say, oh, John Gruden doesn't have him playing. This could be the last year for Derek Carr in Oakland. This might be it for Derek Carr. They can get out from Derek Carr's contract after this season. All the guaranteed money be paid up. It'll be a minimal cap hit. When you look at the move that John Gruden made when he got a couple of first-round picks and he didn't re-sign, he traded away Khalil Mack, he could look at Derek Carr and say, man, you know what? He's struggling for me. He's not the player that I thought he was going to be. I can go in 2019 and I can look at one of these new fancy cars playing in the college game and I can make that guy my franchise quarterback. I think people need to remember in Tampa, he went through 9 different starting quarterbacks.
He's impatient.
Every year was a different starter. And so if Derek Carr doesn't turn this around quickly, and you can't look at the completion percentage, you have to look at the way that he plays and if they win games and score a lot of points. If he doesn't turn it around, John Gruden is going to be there, but there will be a new franchise quarterback in Oakland.
That's big. And by the way, you're seeing something. Last 13 first-round quarterbacks, one bust, Paxton Lynch.
Mm-hmm.
It is used to be a coin flip. You know that, Bucky.
Yep.
I mean, you cross your fingers in the first round. Forget the second, third, fourth. The league is implementing so many college things into pro football that, like, I don't even like Trubisky. And I'm like, oh, he got the right coach.
Oh, yeah.
He got the right RPO. It's like, oh, Mitch Trubisky can win games in the NFL.
Absolutely. So what is happening? And, like, this is something.
It's a good development for the league. You're not having busts. This kid at Oregon, first day will play in the NFL.
Oh, he's going to be terrific.
Star.
There are a lot of quarterbacks in the college ranks that can play. That would be terrific. You can talk about Herbert being a guy.
Justin Herbert, Oregon, his great.
Justin Herbert, Will Greer from West Virginia is going to be solid. You have Jared Stidham.
Tua kid 2 years from Bama.
Tua is going to be outstanding. Drew Locke, all those guys. And all those kids we've seen on the Elite 11 tour. You had Trent here a couple of days. I worked with Trent on the Elite 11 guys. So we've seen them all. And we knew what was coming. And the league is now beginning to catch up to what we've seen at the lower ranks. They're beginning to meet these guys halfway.
Yes.
The smart coaches are being able to take the things that they see on Saturdays and put them into play. I'm going to tell you quickly about a story about Andy Reid. When I bumped into Andy Reid at the combine, Andy Reid coached me at Green Bay. Andy Reid said, look, we weren't even the Baker Mayfield sweepstakes, but I'm looking at all of his tape because the stuff that Oklahoma's doing is outstanding. So lo and behold, what happens when I turn on the games on Sunday? Oh, that's a play that Oklahoma runs. Oh, the fly sweep stuff they're doing with Tyreek Hill. That's the same stuff that you're seeing on Saturdays. The smart coaches are taking Saturday football, and they're making it Sunday, Monday, and Thursday football.
By the way, outrageous. Patrick Mahomes was asked about Tom Brady. He said, yeah, he's one of the best quarterbacks ever. Depends on what you like. You know, like winning. Mahomes is talented, but can we scale back a little? How do we know if he's good pre-snap? How do I know if he's good at the line of scrimmage? How do I know if he's good in hail? How do I know if he's good tough? God, we're going crazy on him.
You're trying to be the dissenting voice on Pat Mahomes. Here's what I'm going to tell you about.
I'm not dissenting, Pat just rational.
Look, and I was lower on Pat Mahomes than I needed to be because I thought he would be a top of the second round talent because he was all scrambles and sandlot ball at Texas Tech. But what I will say about Pat Mahomes is the things that I'm hearing from Chiefs players and coaches remind me of when I was in Green Bay when Brett Favre was winning three straight MVPs. This dude is a unique combination of blue chip talent with a blue collar mentality. He works hard. He does all the dirty work. He's in the film room.
Andrew Luck.
He does all the stuff. He is all of that stuff. And I didn't think. I thought he was a smart kid. We had interviewed him before, but I didn't know. He is all in. And the hope that he gives his teammates makes him a magician. He is what you want as a franchise quarterback. And Andy Reid and Eric Bieniemy have done a great job of tailoring the offense to fit his strengths. And the redshirt year helped him because he didn't have to be rushed onto the field. They could take a 12 to 14 month plan to develop him.
All right, finally here. I have been very critical of wide receivers in general that, you know, I've always said they're the icing, not the cake. Although I did say before this season that because of two rule changes that were both pro receiver, I'm getting more comfortable with paying the guys in the perimeter. I've also been very critical of Odell Beckham, but I will defend him on this, is that every family has to have somebody strong enough to tell grandma she can no longer drive and that grandma stopped talking politics at Thanksgiving. When I watch OBJ and what he said, if the GM won't talk about it, the owner won't talk about it, the media is defending Eli. So you know what I want? I want the biggest star in the franchise to go, we got an issue here. Yeah. By the way, Allen Hurns comes out against Dak. I got Cole Beasley coming out against Dak. You tell me Odell Beckham can't come out against Eli?
Look, it's kind of funny because we always ask our athletes to be honest, to be up front, to be forthright.
Then we crush
him. And then we crush him. So, look, what Odell Beckham Jr. is saying, what every executive around the league is saying about Eli Manning. Eli Manning is no longer the guy that you fear as a quarterback.
That's right.
He hasn't been that guy for the last couple of years. And, in fact, Odell Beckham Jr. basically saved Eli's career when he came in 2014. He elevated his game. Odell Beckham made a ton of plays on catch and run concepts that allow Eli to continue to function. But what you're seeing here, he's the old fighter in the ring who can't get the jab off. He can't throw the right hook. He doesn't have the ability to throw the ball down the field. He can't escape the rush. He has to have a perfect environment. He has to have the best offensive line, the best perimeter players, a running back and everything, and he still can't get it done. At some point, the problem for the Giants lies with number 10. It's not everything around it. Odell Beckham Jr. just shed light on what everyone in the locker room knows to be true about Eli Manning.
He's Larry Holmes, who gave Tyson three good rounds, and then Larry thought he could exchange punches with Tyson, and Tyson knocked him out. Remember Larry at the end?
I did. And I told Dave that he's Muhammad Ali with the mustache. That's who Eli Manning is right now. He's a shell of who he was. Look, he may still go in the Hall of Fame, but he's no longer that guy that we fear. He's not a top 10, a top 15, even a top 20 quarterback.
Great seeing you. Bucky Brooks played Scouts, my friend. Good seeing you.
Thanks.
Joey. No.